Shalom Chavrim, my name is Stephen Ben-Dunoon. The other day I was going along in the story about Elijah and Elisha, where God carries Elijah up in the chariot of fire. And God just really began to deal with me about this story and the prophetic implications that it has for the days that we're living in now and how it reflects Israel's history and in their lives. Something that most people would probably never even think about, at least I had never thought about it. But when God begins to reveal something to your heart, it really begins to resonate. The story can be found in 2 Kings chapter 2, at least the part I'm speaking about here. And we find out that Elijah is getting ready to go up. And Elisha is following him there. He went with him from Gilgal. And Elijah said unto Elisha, "Tarry here, I pray thee, for the Lord hath sent me to Bethel." And Elisha said unto him, "As the Lord liveth, and as thy soul liveth, I will not leave thee." So they went down to Bethel. Now, the interesting thing, what God began to show me here, is that Elijah represents the raptured saints, that future event that has yet to take place. And Elisha, his predecessor, represents Israel. Israel, who is going to have a double portion poured upon them. According to Isaiah 61, and I believe that's found around verse 7, we know in Isaiah 61, it first speaks about Yeshua and his coming. And it says, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, and he has anointed me to preach the acceptable year." But he cuts off in verse 2. And doesn't read the full verse because the day of vengeance of our God and to comfort all that mourn is to be fulfilled in the hour we're living in now. But then he goes to talk about the restoration of Israel. And we get down to verse 7, he says, "For your shame you shall have double, and for confusion they shall rejoice in their portion. Therefore in their land they shall possess the double, everlasting joy shall be unto them." They shall, even says in Isaiah 61, that's Yeshayahu for my Jewish brothers, Yeshayahu, that they would eat the riches of the Gentiles. Now, Isaiah's taking you back to the time of when the story of Joseph stored up the grain. So we know that it represents what is called Daniel's 70th week. Anyway, going back real quick to the story of Elijah, what happens we find here? Elisha steadfast sticks with him because what is it? The Jewish people know, the Christian people love them. But there's one specific group of Christians made up from around the world, from different walks of life, different paths, different denominations that they have come out of. But they're ones that really love Israel. They're not replacement theologists, but they love Israel. And the time will come when they get ready to go up, that Israel's going to know it. And why? Why is Israel going to know it? Well, we find out when you get down to, when you come down to Jericho in verse 5, it says, "And the sons of the prophets that were at Jericho came to Elisha and said unto him, Knowest thou that the Lord will take away thy master from thy head today?" Who are these prophets? Who are these sons of Jericho? I believe that these are those Christians that end up going into tribulation in modern days, because we notice they never go up. In fact, their own testimony, when after Elijah goes up, and then they come to Elisha and said, "Let us send 50 to go out and see if maybe his body fell out upon a mountain." They didn't fully believe the word of God, and yet supposed to be prophets. Well, the Bible says they were prophets. And in days that we live in now, people are prophesying all the time, having dreams. And not saying that some of those are not truly bride, truly those ones that'll be like Elijah and go up. The ones that are going up, though, they don't doubt the word of God a single bit. In fact, though, we find out what happens when Elijah crosses the Jordan River and he goes along and Elisha's walking with him. Of course, he lays his mantle on the water parts, they walk apart across the Jordan on dry ground. And he asks the question, he says, "What would I do for you?" And he says, "I'd like a double portion of your spirit." He says, "Well, if you see me when you go," but he said, "You asked a hard thing, but if you see me when I go, it'll be granted unto you." And of course, we know the story. He sees him when he goes. He comes back. Now there's 50 of the prophets standing there. But an interesting thing happens, and this was a question that has puzzled me for years. What provokes Israel to jealousy? We read in the scripture that Israel be provoked to jealousy by the Gentiles. What is it, though, that really provokes them to jealousy? Well, I've had different brothers speculate with this over the years, and they said, I believe it's the rapture. Because certainly as I look at the churches around, and no disregard to the people in these churches, but the Catholic Church, the Methodist Church, the Baptist Church, the Pentecostal Church, every one of them's got a different opinion, different idea, you know, charismatic, ecclesiastical, whatever you want to call them. Well, ecclesia, they're all joined back up in with the Vatican now. They're all becoming back to the mother that they started with. God's not going to take anybody up like that. He's looking for a called out, sold out individual. So what happens? Well, when Elijah goes up and Elisha comes back, we find not long after that, there were two children that came out and they begin to make fun of him. They called him the old bald head. In fact, it says here in verse 23, and he went up from thence to Bethel, and he was going up the way. There came forth little children out of the city and mocked him and said unto him, go up, thou bald head, go up, thou bald head. And he turned back, speaking of Elisha, he turned back and looked on them and cursed them in the name of Hashem. And there came forth two she-bears out of the wood and tear 42 children of them. And he went from thence to Mount Carmel, and from thence he returned to Samaria. The children, in fact, Brother Chad, good brother here, I was so perplexed when God was revealing all this to me. I got to the part about the 42 children. I knew there was something meant there by it. I couldn't figure it out, and I kept praying about it. Brother Chad said, Brother Steve, it's the 42 months. He was right. It's the 3.5 years. The two she-bears represent the two witnesses. Why? What? Why is it a she-bear? God knows that a mother, when her cub is in danger, that mother will do anything. These children are the future generations. That's why it speaks of children. It's the future generation that'll mock Israel. What? When? When Yeshua takes his little bride and she goes into her flight there, the little church that gets left behind, they will mock Israel and say, well, you're the chosen ones. Yes, those replacement theologists, they'll begin to mock Israel and say, why didn't you go up, you old bald head? Why didn't you go up? You're the anointed of God. How come you didn't go up? And see, Elisha, in a jealous rage, because he wanted to go, but he had missed out. So he cursed those children. And those two she-bears represents the two witnesses that have come on the scene. Moses and Elijah, as far as what I can see. And they will bring judgment upon the earth for 42 months. God bless you. And have a good night.